I think there is a lot of big picture discussion to have about the right technology stack to move forward. But it's interesting, you know, you and I talked off camera about my historic coverage of the automotive industry. You are going beyond the automotive industry. I wonder how much you need this capital to do that, expand the offering into other markets.
Yeah, thank you for having me. I think the direct answer is we don't need the capital. The company's been a functioning business for a bunch of years. But I think the association that you're making is correct. I mean, it's not random that the General Motors headquarters is a few miles from the General Dynamics headquarters, technical headquarters. So these industries share a lot of the componentry that makes a car, a truck, and a tank, a tank. And increasingly, as the kind of important component of that product is intelligence, a company like ours can, you know, share that across multiple industries. And why it's so valuable for customers, it's cheaper for everybody.
You mentioned tanks. How much have you shifted the business, or has it naturally shifted to the defense technology use case?
Yeah, we've been a dual use company from fairly early, but about a year into the company's history, so it's not a recent change. But the realities that you're seeing in the passenger car environment or robo-taxis, they're the same realities on infantry squad vehicles or tanks or even jets and planes, which is the defining characteristic of these products is going to be the intelligence. It's, you know, all the other stuff I think we've figured out pretty effectively, and the kind of the manufacturers have figured out pretty effectively.
So, Qasar, as the age-old question goes, you raise the money for what? You say the next phase of vehicle intelligence. What is it you're going to produce?
Well, I can give you a generic answer about increasing our product lines. what every single founder probably comes on here. And so I'll give you the more, you know, all our values can be reduced to radical pragmatism. So I'll give you the more pragmatic and direct answer, which is a big portion of the company's compensation for all of our employees is through equity. And you want to have independent investors who come in as a private company and look at the books and look at the products and basically figure out how much you're worth, and that allows you to more accurately value your equity that you're giving out as compensation. Also, it's good just to have new people come look at your business as a private company. I think one of the really, there's a lot of, you know, a lot of hate for public companies or going public, but one of the really positive things about being a public company is that you are kind of almost exposed. That means you have to have a really good business and a really, really robust, you know, product pipeline, et cetera, because that's part of being a public company.
Yeah.
So I think it's us just kind of warming up to that, you know, and building those muscles.
Okay, you're taking us there. New investor BlackRock, how quickly do they want to see you go public if this is a Series F?
Yeah, I think, you know, we've been super fortunate, whether it's them or Fidelity or Franklin or Bond, a bunch of the kind of late stage investors. They've been extremely, let's say, you know, they're not giving us guidance. They really want to support the company in the next phase and whatever that might be. I think as we think about those things, I mean, IPO is definitely something we would think about in the future, but no guidance on that just yet. When I was doing the prep for this, the finance team said, if they ask about IPO, they put in bold letters, do not engage.
So. Thanks for engaging that much.
Yeah, thank you for doing so. Look, it's a big week for Robotaxi,
yeah.
Tesla soft launching in Austin. The big picture technology debate is a sister solely based on cameras or a multi-suite approach with camera, LiDAR, radar for redundancy. You sit in the supply chain.
Yeah.
Where do we end up?
Yeah, I think it's I wouldn't have this kind of almost binary view that one is going to be the future and the other one's going to fail. I think there's a version, the very realistic versions, both will exist in the ecosystem. Maybe another way to think about this is if we're doing mobile phones. If you're going to say, hey, you're going to have a $400 mobile phone and a $1,800 folding phone, that's the high end. Both are serving very different kind of markets.
And then there's the software. Who do you see as having software superiority?
Yeah.
Your Waymos, your Zooks, or your Teslas?
So I think, again, it's not a either or. So let me just define a little bit of why it's different. So the passenger car version, or the, let's say, broadly speaking, the Tesla version is, there's a driver in the loop right now, pending this announcement that's coming up. And the Waymo version is there's no driver in the loop. If you don't have somebody sitting in that front seat, the redundancy that you need and, let's say, the robustness of the software has to be greater, and the compute and all of those things that are gonna make that self-driving tech more safe. When you have a driver in the loop, somebody who's sitting there for edge cases, you can actually have less sensors and you can have kind of less cost. And so really, like the car business, like many businesses, the cost business. So if you have high costs, you need that to be shared across lots of riders. If you have low cost, that can be owned by an individual.